speaker.
Or a mouse.
I have a mouse.
Okay, you get the display for me? So last year I started, in Australia when I was talking like briefly, I started feeling that I finally feel comfortable presenting at the conference. But right after that I started getting into like stage fright kind of thing. Like my heart gets pulled up and I start, my work starts breaking. So if I do that, just give me a shout.
The CSS? And, I considered it and rejected it.
Yeah,
I wanted it to chop, but that's too ugly.
Yeah.
I think people get it. Okay, let's start. So, the the one nice thing about, the only nice thing about not being at Guadalajara for 4 years is I have a lot of stuff to talk about. I just read through them. I reused one of my most recent deck, but I really added stuff to it, I removed stuff. So we'll see how it works. I'm going to talk about the story of the Heart Club Indie Paper. The something called the Universal Symphony Engine, Notofont, Colorfont, and then TrueType GX. Not going to talk about regional font tools. If you are interested in those, just talk to me. I have different decks for those. So what's the thing with the Heart Club Shaper? So when I got started at Red Hat, Owen was moved to this project called Moksha, if you remember. So I ended up maintaining Pango. And the problem with Pango was, well, the problem with the Linux desktop was there were two different index shapers, one in ICU, one in Pango, which was ported from ICU, and then KDE had another one. And then I had to maintain the tech stack, and there was a stream of incoming bugs that this particular sequence with this particular font work in GNOME but not KDE or LibreOffice, or work in KDE and GNOME but not LibreOffice. Then I had to do things about it. Now, the problem was the fonts were developed by, well, outsourced, bought by Red Hat, so they were open source fonts. And this was open source code, and it was just not clear whose bug this is. And I didn't know anything about any scripts or what user behavior is. So what I ended up doing is, when the internationalization team from India or Asia sent me a patch, I just committed it, like this. Blah, 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 do what I was told to do. And the code started adding more if than if than if than if. And the other problem was, this was the original shaper was a state machine, a hand-coded state machine with a table, transition table, coded in. But over time, it became very clear that we need more states. This is just not complex enough for the problem. So the if got added. No one. I didn't know how to update the state machine or what it's supposed to do. So it was too magical. So around 2006, I started rewriting Harvard, and then by 2010-11, I started attacking the indie problem. So I figured that I'd develop a new shaper to replace them all. And then I started just studying Unicode and OpenType indie exceptions. This is from the OpenType Devanagari spec. It gives you a regular expression, looks easy. So I converted that to code in a language called Regel. Well, I tried like 4 or 5 different compiler generators. I settled on this one. It's very powerful, very handy. It looks different, but it's the direct translation of the same regular expression. And then the spec has these character classes. That's like data types going into the machine. And I found that Unicode has data files that map very clearly to this type. So I took the data from Unicode, regular expression from OpenType, put them together, and then this was the algorithm in the spec, so I just copied it into my code that I started filling in. But I had no idea how to test it. I had about 200 tests from Qt. I started making the path after several passes. I started doubting that the test suite is correct. So that was a sobering up moment. I figured that given how underspecified OpenType is and Unicode is, what Windows does is what OpenType is. So from a font developer point of view, or a user point of view for that matter, same text, same font must render the same on Windows or our platform. So that's when I developed two tools called HPView, HPShape, which take a font, take text, show you what's going to happen, render it or just print out the list of glyphs. So for example, this is this font text, this is the HP shape output, it tells you the glyph name, cluster mapping, position advances. This is all I need. This is a textual representation of the shape. And then I implemented the Uniscribe backend for Harfuzz, so I can run it against Uniscribe and compare the output. For that matter, I added a Cortex backend as well. So after this, we figured that even this is not enough. Even if I had 1,000 tasks, that wouldn't give me any confidence that this code is worth it. So I went to my colleague Ruth at Google, said, well, we are Google. Go download the entire internet, give me a word list, I want to test it out. Well, we spent all the time downloading all of Wikipedia. So we downloaded all of Wikipedia, created a master word list per language, it's about like 1 million words per language, and started testing those against fonts. Well, we started with the default Windows font. So for example, the Devanagari font, Mango, 1 million words takes about 2-3 seconds to run all of those words against Uniscript. I'm half of them compared to the app. And we started doing this with Jonathan Kiyo at Mozilla. We started meeting 1 week every quarter or so and just drilling down the test numbers. I figure it's integers, I can get it to zero. So this is what I've developed the diff tool. This is what the diff looks like. And the nice thing about it is, as soon as you see this, the pattern emerges. I know exactly this form is not being formed in my code, and then I go debug the font and figure out what Uniscript is doing. I'm essentially reverse engineering Uniscript. And this number here is the frequency rank of the word. So this is like the 150,000th most frequent word on Wikipedia in Devanagari. So first time we met, 30% failure, we got it down to 8% of a percent. Over time, we got like numbers for a bunch of scripts. They went down, and some of them went up, because on the way, we started discovering Uniscript bugs. So we do have a Uniscript bug compatible mode, but even on that, we are not so successful emulating all the bugs. So, and many times we decide that something makes more, we can improve on things, so when it's a clear winner, we improve on things. But this has been the main framework we use to develop the index paper to the state that it is today. And then while added, we added a Myanmar shaper, a Japanese, and something called the Southeast Asia, which was a catch-all for Indic-like scripts of Southeast Asia. And then, to give Firefox the confidence to use this instead of Uniscript on Windows, Jonathan brought up this dashboard of Amazon AWS that runs Firefox against all the fonts, all the languages, and visualizes the output. Now, the visualization part is not complete, so we don't have it run every day, but whenever he wants to update Firefox to roll Firefox in Firefox, he runs that. It's been immensely useful. And the main problem is it's a data problem. It's like the amount of output this is produced is in the terabytes, and it's like just storing them and comparing them is not scalable. But then something else happened. About last year, a year ago, I invited OpenType experts from various companies, all the OpenType implementers, to meet. We met at the Google Seattle office. There were experts from Microsoft, Apple, Adobe, and Google. And we just talked about how to do index better and what to do for other scripts. And then we started the week by a certain Microsoft employee saying the OpenType shaper specs are property of Microsoft. And then, but we ended the week by like on the whiteboard discussing the details of how to do shaping using Unicode data for a variety of scripts. And then we separated, agreed that we should work on this. And it didn't happen, except for 6 months later at the Unicode conference, Andrew Glass of Microsoft and John Hodgson announced this universal shaping engine that they developed. So they released this spec. It's based on the same idea as take the Unicode data, put it into a very complete graphing model, and do minimal reordering. So this is the graphing model. Comes with, again, another regular expression. Very simple, very clean. For the first time, it looks like the spec was written at the same time as the implementation, although it's clear that they are written by different people. So, 2-3 weeks ago, I got together with Jonathan again in London, and we implemented the Universal Shaper Engine. And then we merged it, and at that point, I figured, well, this is the catch-all shaper I've been waiting for, so half of it's done. So release half was 1.00. Only took about 10 years. So that was the harp was part of the story. But harp was only the shaping. To make reading accessible to billions of people, you also need funds. That's what the Noto funds at Google are about. Google owns two operating systems, and you need default funds for the operating system. So my colleagues have been working on Noto project for over 4 or 5 years. They contract external font developers like Monotype and Adobe to develop fonts, and then our team does the testing and QA and shipping them. The idea is all of Unicode, homogeneous design, and open source. So depending on the script, there might be 1 to 7 bits, for example, for the Chinese, Japanese, Korean, we have 1 to 7 bits, I think. 90 plus scripts, it's like over 600,000 scripts, it's just massive. It's the biggest font project ever done. It has sans and serif style for subscript, for Arabic, it has Nath, Kufi, and Nathalie. For Syriac, for example, at the bottom, it has 3 different styles. They don't look the same, it's just 3 different styles of the serif script. And we have color and black and white emoji. Noto comes with language-specific glyph variations. For example, the Arabic phrases Urdu have different variations. If you specify the language, it chooses the right variation. For other scripts, support vertical text, geographic variation sequencing. So for example, here, the Hindi and Nepali lines, they are the same Unicode sequence. It's just a different rendering style for different languages. So imagine if in HTML, if you specify the language, you get different rendering. And then the Vedic signs are signs used to write Sanskrit. Very, very few Indic fonts happen, but like in Noto, we go the extra mile to cover everything, not just a modern usage or anything. Oh, Nathalie, my favorite. So this is Noto Nathalie Urdu. Nathalie is a style of writing Arabic script. It's extremely popular in Pakistan. It's the only accepted style. All the newspapers are in Nathalie, even something handwritten to this day. And it poses challenges to doing computers because it has this cascading style, and then the positioning it correctly is really, really hard, especially with OpenType. So the story here is, 2-3 years ago, this guy wrote like American, brave Pakistani, wrote this article on medium.com, the death of the Urdu script, right? How the Western companies are killing our culture and everything. And it didn't get much attention initially, but a couple years later, or a year later, it became really popular on Twitter and Reddit and stuff. And then there was, and then someone else on Medium wrote this open letter to Tim Cook asking that they support Urdu on Apple products, and Tim Cook wrote back. He wrote back on October 13, promising that they work on it. And it was really funny because for over 2 years at that, 1 or 2 years at that time, we were working with Monotype on Noto Nathalie. And we almost had the font ready. So we decided to just put it out there. So a couple weeks later, a month later, we released it as a draft one. And we decided, well, let it just break the internet. Well, Internet Explorer Harpaz did a very good job of handling it. Firefox was fine. If you try to use the font in Firefox, it just froze Firefox for 5 seconds, but otherwise worked. But the bug in Harpaz, by the way. HP Cortex, HP Cortex layer works fine, but I get the Cortex layer. Chrome Mac works now because it uses Harpaz instead of Cortex. Cairo PDF was broken, we got it fixed. My font subsidiary was broken, I got it fixed. Those are the good parts. Uniscribe does an okay job. It has a couple of minor bugs, but it's very good. Cortex and Safari have serious bugs, the serious position, things collapse. As far as I know, they fixed one of them, shipped the update to update Cortex. But in general, they're not useful with this one. Chrome PDF has no hope, Flash has no hope, InDesign has no hope. Now, Cortex and Safari might have improved because 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, I received an email from someone at Apple saying that as I might have noticed, they're shipping Lotus Labs started in OS X. Like iOS 9 ships the file. So I figured someone at Apple should have got a handsome bonus like shipping this. Anyway, so that's a Lotus story. And then color files. So there's four formats. So 5 years ago, if you told someone we are going to ship colored files, they would say you're crazy. Well, Owen Taylor said like color doesn't have anything to do with that text API, it's kind of. But people love emoji. It started in Japan, just took over the world. It's if you haven't noticed, emoji and Unicode are in the news like every month, every week. Like the Ibada Colbert Report, it's like all over the place. Like the skin tone stuff, it's just crazy. So Apple had this spec, the table they were shipping on the iOS devices. They embedded PNG images, the spec wasn't public, they had no interest to share it. So at Google, well, I did the same. I just added PNG images to the existing bitmap table that we shipped it. And then a month later, Microsoft announced their own, which is more of a Metro design style. It's multiple solid color glyphs on top of each other. And then Mozilla and Adobe have been working on this SVG-based extension to OpenTile for years. It shipped shortly after in Firefox. So we had these four different implementations of the same thing. And the nice thing is, well, Apple doesn't like to play with anyone on OpenTile, but the rest of us got together and we all agreed that there are three different approaches to the same problem, all valid, and now all three are part of the OpenTile spec. And I'm working on implementing Microsoft and Adobe's. Microsoft is working on implementing Google's. It's like everyone wants to implement everyone. Now, Firefox OS supports all four of them. But unfortunately, Cairo, I produced a proof of concept for Cairo years ago. No one finished it, and I haven't finished it. I should, but like, there's any volunteers for Cairo, Pixman, X-Men, there needs more work. Yeah, maybe XDGM. Okay, so that covers what I've done in the past, but the stuff I'm working on more recently, I'm really, really excited about. And it goes back to two technologies that existed about 20 years ago. They still exist, just not used. And one is TrueType.gx from Apple and Multiple Master from Adobe. So if you've been paying attention to the design choices of recent years on iOS, Android, people love the thin fonts at large sizes. Like, people want more weights. Doesn't matter, like any particular document may only use 2 or 3 weights, but people want a variety of weights, more choice. So what font designers have been doing is they design 2 or 3 masters. In this case, Roboto has only 2 masters at the extremes. And then interpolate the middle, create binary, ship it. So last year I decided, well, this is stupid. We should just ship the masters and interpolate at runtime. And that's exactly what TrueType.gx is about, exactly what Multiple Master is about. Now, TrueType.gx was the winner here because it was already implemented in FreeType. It's already shipping on Apple, on all of Apple devices, just unused. So we worked with Werner and other people out of DoorDog to fix bugs in the FreeType implementation. The problem is the spec is underspecified, misses like major parts of the design. And no one knows how it works. No one knew how it works anymore. So we have to reverse engineer that one too. Like, the funny thing is the two people who designed it, I work with regularly. One of them is the SCIA lead at Google. The other one is the lead font engineer at Monotype. But it has been lost over the years. So we have to backtrack everything. We have a working implementation in FreeType. And then the main problem why GX failed was there was no tool support for it. People didn't know how to generate these fonts. So with font tools, which is the Python font manipulation library I maintain, my colleagues implemented GX tables in font tools. So now you can convert the GX font to XML, modify it, put it back, or programmatically put together GX font. So developed this 200 line of code to read the masters, put them in one GX font, and then it renders on Apple or Vita, you get something like this. It's the same font, same cliff, you just change the width and stretch axis. And this morning I managed to get that running on the Linux desktop, but I'm Chrome. So jump to demos. Questions so far? Okay, let's see. Demo guard. So this is using my past card of yes. Here. Okay. So this is real text. Let me try to bring up here the copy it. You know, I don't have proper font config tools to prefer the color font, but if I set it here. Yeah, so it's text. Yeah. Let's see, let me save it here. You know, let me nuke this Ubuntu font. Or how do I do fonts.conf? That would be a good idea. Let's see what happens. It took a few seconds. Yes. Okay. So let's move on to the variation. We moved this menu here every time. So I have a source fonts example here. Source fonts is the open source font by Adobe, amazing font. Let's see. We don't have the font installed, so let's install it. Takes a few seconds. I've reduced this time at in Chrome settings demon master from 5 seconds to the like half a second, but here is so it's like one font. It's a true text collection, true, but it has two faces, the regular and the small caps. Each of those is a GX with a weight axis. So let's see. So if I modify the file, add like 10 lines of XML, designing 10 new weights, it just works. So imagine the next GNOME Asia named GNOME release, you might like get a tweak tool that you could just have a slider for weight and one for stretch and possibly one for optical size. And so that's the direction we're going on. Honestly, GNOME is the perfect prototyping tool for this kind of thing. I know it in and out, and then it's just so easy. Imagine doing that on Android, well, I think. But so that's basically all I have here. Question time.
I'm just gonna ask about the master for the parametric font. Like, what are the tools to create those? Like, I just want to ask.
Now, so the question was, what's the input master to this tool to put the GX font together? Surprise, it's just a master that font designers have been designing. In fact, for source fans, we just got the existing masters from GitHub and ran through the script. So font designers already design fonts in a, it's called an interpolation compatible way, which means each grid has the same composition, same number of Bezier curves, same number of points, just the points move. So people have been doing that way already. So it doesn't matter, we can load Griff app fonts with the, or source, we can use UFO font forge, doesn't matter. Just give me the masters, tell me what composition you want to do, we put it together. Well, this is all still happening. It should be open source within a month or so. But yeah, the basic support is already in font tools, which is where we put all our code. Is we have tools to put the GX table together. When there are other libraries to read UFO, we develop the library to load Glyph app files directly into Python. So just connect them all together and get the fun. Go ahead. No? Yeah.
You presented this not a font as a replacement or something that should include all the glyphs in all languages, as far as understood?
So the question is not a font a replacement for fonts to include every language?
Like in Tails, we include a lot of different fonts and regularly have a request to include another font because somebody using a language that we don't know tells us that it doesn't work for them. So my question is not a font ready to replace all this or not yet?
My question is not a font ready to replace all the various fonts you need to have to support every language. Yes, that's what Noto does. It's the default font on Android and other platforms, possibly. So one of the things I want to talk to people tomorrow at the typography bar is to move in that direction exactly. But Noto is designed exactly for this, to be the homogeneous font that is your base. People always will want other fonts, but this is the base. No one should get a tofu box for the language anymore.
That's great, thank you.
Thanks. Christian?
Do you think we should be supporting the embedded PNG fonts as well? Do we already do that?
The embedded PNG fonts, well, that's what it is. That's what the Puchan app was. That was the
start. I guess my question is, should we be investing any time to make, if we all of a sudden have actually empathy working, communicating with someone who's on an SMS on an Apple phone, do we want that to look similar?
Well, so that's the nice thing about Unix. The question is, well, I just explained. So this is Unicode text. So if I send this to someone on Apple, they get the same idea in Apple's font.
So the mapping of the actual code points is the
these
same.
These are characters.
Okay.
These are real Unicode characters.
So even though they use different technology to implement it, they are
at least coordinated
on the.
Oh yeah, that was the big thing. That was why Unicode accepted it, because in Japan there were like at least three different implementations by different carriers, SoftBank and if you send text from one to the other, they couldn't read it. So that's why Unicode is not a image like encoding thing, but they did this because of that, to solve that problem. That said, I also implemented Apple spec in free type, so I might be able to load Apple font here if I have it. Yeah, it's the Apple font. We don't have the Microsoft or SVG implementation yet, but someday we will. Why? Okay. Any other? No? Go ahead.
Do you know anything about the performance of the color fonts compared to regular ones?
The performance of the color fonts, honestly, doesn't matter. All the graphic libraries cache this. Cache them, escape. And like in the texting, like we are so far from being performance bottlenecks in loading plants that it doesn't matter. It's like everything performance wise comes from your graphics library and how fast you can re-render the same thing.
Okay, great.
Anyway,
Do you have a roadmap or like a list of things that are left to do for your Cairo / Bitcoin / Bendry?
Yes, thank you. So basically what I did is, in FreeType I added API that says you can request color. If you don't request color, we convert it to grayscale. So everything works. Like in Fedora, if you use these fonts, you get the grayscale rendering. That works. On the Cairo side, all you need to do is request color if the surface is colored, and then update all the compositors that Chris Nielsen added supported. So on the X server long term, we need an XRender extension to pass it through the server. But in the meantime, the idea is as soon as you see a colorful glyph, use fallback. And then, well, ideally update Pixman text API to support that. That should be trivial. But for now, the path that I have disables the Pixman compositor for text, and then always uses the image fallback compositors, and there is trivial. It's just you got the ARGB32. Instead of it being like pre-channel alpha, you just know it's an image. So I think we want to keep using image fallback for this thing. We don't want to implement it in all the different compositors. So it should be really, for someone who knows Cairo these days, shouldn't be too much work. The problem is no one knows.
Thank you.
No?
Yeah. Just fun.
Sure.
Does this work with your OpenGL renderer?
The color one? No. Let's see.
Because I would like to see some animated emoji.
Well, the problem is, you don't want to.
At around 1,000.
You know, actually, dude, should I do a demo? No. This is Robert Collins demo. Browse. Look at this. Let's modify it. Let's make it go faster. Is it updating? No. Why? Well, that's the feel. That's a little deviation, 3 seconds. So, yeah, but that won't happen on the desktop. Well, the problem is with Griffy, the OpenGL thing, these ones are bitmap. So I don't know what it does actually, let's see. How do I get the color? One. 4, 9, 8. What? I have no idea what happened. But when I can demo this, I don't know what changed, but my clock doesn't get an initial rendering anymore. So this Cliffy is an OpenGL shading language based rasterizer. Every frame is rasterized on the GPU, on the spot. There's no caching going on. And the nice thing about it is, I can do this. Go try doing that with like FreeType and Cairo and X. And if the mouse helps, do this. As if everyone needs that. One of my favorite is the. No. Let me see. No.
It's the cute desk.
No. How do I do the left? No. Oh. Well, I want to zoom. If you can zoom with the mouse, it's really smooth. This is like a keyboard. But what this is doing is that every frame, for every shape, every pixel, it's looking into this data structure, list of arcs stored in a texture, finds the closest arc, computes the distance to the arc, and then decides what color to use. And it runs like, let me see how many frames I get. Do you know how to disable the meshing here? I have it here. Leave blank mode here. So if I do this one, and let me zoom in so we get every pixel going on. So this should be capped at 60 frames right now. And this is the retina, well, this is the, oh, it looks awful there. It
there's
looks
there's
much
no better. Sync. For the
projector. It looks much better on my laptop. But this is 60. If I do the mid blank here. Now it looks awful on the laptop as well. No, because there's no V-sync. But it's probably doing 100 dpi. 100 frames. And I haven't optimized this because there was never a use case or a client for it. But the good news is, Marcus, who will talk about LibreOffice later today, is working on porting the LibreOffice OpenGL renderer to use Cliffy. So that's really exciting for me. This is technology I did like 4 or 5 years ago. Just now, like the hardware, mobile hardware is become just good enough to be able to use this on it. So I'm really excited about it.
Now that there's now that we have GL in GTK directly, do you think there ever makes sense to investigate that for us there?
So the reason LibreOffice can do it is they can always use their existing implementation and only use OpenGL if the hardware is good enough. On GTK, we still have to support all hardware and low DPI display, so it will be a mess. And if you think about how we currently get text, the FreeType flows into Cairo X render, X server hardware, it's just a mess. Having a direct, like a completely separate path from it, from GTK directly to the hardware and maintaining it, it wouldn't work. It's just too much work. I don't know anyone who wants to do that. But one day, like, I don't know, maybe. So. Yeah, exactly. Like, Wayland makes things so much easier, true. Okay, we're almost out of time. Any last notes or questions or comments? No? Well, thanks. Thanks for being here.